Today, I show you how I created my first single slab table, which was also my biggest client order yet, what I learned along the way, and also I do some freestyle power carving. Enjoy!
This is gonna be so much fun! Yay!
Today's a special day, you know? I finally got a huge order for a dining table and couldn't wait to get started. If you've watched my workshop vlogs, you might be familiar with those two huge ash slabs.
This is why I studied physics! Oh. It works out so nicely! Yes! Okay, I think it would be harder to lift it up here. And yeah. Which side is better? I think that's the wrong side. I shouldn't use this one. Yeah, it's time to put it down again, I suppose.
I think you can see why this side isn't the best one to use. I mean, it's a huge slab. It won't tip when I use the router on it, but just to make sure, I'm going to put it with the concave side downwards, just because it's going to give me a more stable setup in the process.
My client decided to choose the one which was less rectangular and asked me to keep it as natural as possible, meaning I had to preserve the live edge. First thing on my agenda was to simply flatten both sides using my huge flattening jig that I've built a few videos ago. All relevant links can be found down there in the description, by the way.
This right here, ladies and gentlemen, is the true big chungus. I think you need a license to use this weapon. It has 1/2 inch of diameter just for the shaft. It's ridiculous. I had to buy myself this 1/2 inch diameter shaft for my Festool router. I'm seriously afraid to use that thing. There's a lot of power behind bits of this diameter. It's outright ridiculous. Yeah, it's freaking crazy. I also have a smaller one, but for this big of a slab, I think the bigger one would be more suitable. I'm not certain. Just imagine I missed the direction of the router up. If I do an accidental climb cut with this thing, it's gonna be fatal. But I think I know the direction. I do hope so. Yeah, let's use the big one. Let's go in completely. I'm so afraid. I'm so terribly afraid of this thing. No need to be afraid, that thing works so smooth. It's ridiculous. You nearly hear no voice, it's so quiet, I could even go deeper. This is crazy. Great performance, I love it. Let's continue. Nearly no heat. This thing was worth its $150, I think. That's a great bit, that's a seriously great bit. And it's not even carve, right? It's amazing.
Greatest thing about that is always the mess that it produces. And I can see clearly in here. It's dusty everywhere. I need to put on my mask once again, my respirator. But yeah, such a lot of fun. I can still sell those, believe it or not. And we are almost done flattening that one. It already looks ridiculously good. Yeah, awesome. Awesome results. And it didn't even take that long. I think for one phase, it takes me like 10 minutes. That is ridiculously fast with this router bit. I'm so pleased, so pleased. Just look at the grain, it gets better and better the deeper we get. Ah, oh, such a beautiful one. That's going to be a great tabletop once finished.
There's dust everywhere.
There's dust seriously everywhere.
It's so dusty in here. But I got the first side flat. Do not wonder I forgot my camera at home today. So I'm using my MacBook at the moment. Now I'm looking for my broom and then we can see what the slab looks like. Looks pretty fantastic in my opinion. Is it just me or is that slab looking kinda fake? That is, look at that grain. This is outright ridiculous. It nearly looks like olive. Okay, let us now check if the whole thing is actually square, because I'm wondering if the suit jig is actually working the way it's supposed to. But from here it looks terribly square. Let's see.
Whoa, looking square to me. There is no light shining through. That's an amazing result. Now I can just hope
that it won't bow too much in the next few days before putting in the seed channels. I'm a little bit afraid. Now we are going to turn the whole thing around and then we are going to flatten the other side. With one reference face already flat, I can just put it on the other side and then start milling again. Yeah, looking fine. So satisfied with the result. Let's go. I think we can all agree that the performance of this cutter is outright ridiculous. Link down there in the description. It's seriously worth its 150 bucks approximately. Okay, now I'm going to rough sand this whole thing such that I get rid of these marks. You can't really do anything about those marks that you get after routing. And yeah, then we already did a great job, I suppose. I'm still waiting for my Arbotech mini carver, which I'm going to use to basically, here we had to take something off with the chainsaw such that I can fit it in my car. Maybe you can see it here a tiny little bit. So I need to basically imitate the live edge of the slab with a carving device. Never did that before, but that's certainly going to be a lot of fun. And also I need to get rid of all the bark right here. We don't want the bark. By the way, this right here is the downside. The live edge is going to point downwards as a natural chamfer, you can say. There's still a bit of stuff to do, but not too much, so let's get to work.
Sanding took a while, but I got both faces done in about 30 minutes with an 80 grit.
That took a while, but it was still totally fine. Now I'm sitting on my shop rack. As always, I'm extremely curious as to how the grain is going to look once finished. So I'm going to water pop this one, and it's also something for you to really enjoy. So yeah, let's go ahead and get started. This is only the downside, the back side. On the other side, we have way more hardwood, which is going to look even better. Yeah, let us pop that bitch and then we are going, no, let us pop that wood cherry and then we are going to continue our work with removing the bark from the live edge. I think this is going to be a bit of a harder task. We'll see. This is obviously only going to give you a rough estimate for how it's going to look at the very end, but I think we can all agree that it already looks rather fantastic. And once finished with Rubio monocoat, it's going to look even more fantastic. It's going to really pop. And cool thing about the slab is that we have a lot of curl here. So we got curl at the parts on the live edge, also on the other side, and we also got a curious kind of curl here, which is rather interesting.
Next came a few cosmetic procedures, such as cutting parallel ends with my track saw and Japanese pole saw. Planing the end grain square with my Japanese cutter. as well as chamfering both ends with my router for these spicy looks. The slab had just a few minor cracks at its ends. The client wasn't very fond of me using bow ties, so we decided to go with a different route, namely pale white epoxy. The resin is really only there to stabilize the cracks and to keep them from further opening up due to moisture differences in my client's home. I also sealed off the end grain with resin too, to keep the slab from drying out or absorbing moisture too quickly later on. Next, we will try to keep the slab from naturally straightening out along the grain. Or, in other words, we will embed seed channels at the bottom to prevent the piece of wood from bowing or carping. The seed channels are made out of steel, and after cutting them to size, I started to mark out their positions on the slab. Once that was done, I routed out the shaft where they will slide into using a set of ball bearing assist template bits for my Festool router. Then I clean up the shaft using my corner and a regular chisel. And there we go, perfect fit. Nice, very satisfying to look at. I fastened the seed channels rather loosely later using threaded inserts and bolts. This is always by far the most annoying part about table builds, in my opinion, and no fun at all. But what needs to be done has to be done. So let's quickly get this over with, shall we? Never, and I say never, fasten those too tightly. We want to allow the wood to move. Screw them in too hard and your wood will crack instead. That would suck, right? Done. Nice. Now let's rinse and repeat on the other side, and then we'll get to installing the base. The steel base has been provided to me by my client, so I had to deal with whatever he's gotten for me. At first, I centered the base and marked the positions of the plates. Then, I used my trusty CNC to create some templates, such that I could easily route those marked sections out, inserting the base flush into the slab in the process. Fitting perfectly. Nice. Next came the fun part. Again, 16 times. Yay.
So most things turn out very nicely up until now when it comes to inserting the seed channels and the like, but I've got a huge problem with the space. I left a bit of clearance for all of the parts which would go into the wood, where the wood lies on. But the thing is, all of those platforms that you got here, those four touching the wood, are not coplanar. I loosened those screws when my client got the base here. They already weren't coplanar. I loosened those screws, they are not tightly screwed up until now, tightly fastened, but they are not coplanar, meaning they are always at some kind of angle touching the wood, and this makes it really hard to assemble, and this also makes the clearance look rather weird, a bit uneven, not how I predicted it would be. Yeah, these are the problems you deal with when you don't manufacture stuff on your own and have to deal with hardware that someone gives to you. But it's the downside of the table, so no one's going to see it. My client knows it, we talked about it, and all is good. But it still poses a tiny little problem when fastening all of the screws. But gladly, we are using threaded inserts, meaning we always have a little bit of wiggle room and we can fasten them very tightly, even though they are not coplanar at all. Let's continue. There was a bit of work, but I got it done. Yeah, we are almost done. Now I'm simply waiting for my mini carver by Arbotech. It should have arrived by now in my home, so I can start carving tomorrow. And then it's only sanding and some fine tuning, like a bit more chamfering on the live edge. Yeah, I'm pretty satisfied with how everything turned out up until now. Is that a certified Bourbon Moff's woodworking moment? He does shit like that, right? I should also eat some glue, I suppose. Let's go.
I didn't want to sit around and do nothing until my carver arrived. So I already went ahead and prepared my underside for finishing. First, sanding all the way up from an 80 to a 320 grit. Cleaning the surface and ridding it of all the dust using Rubio cleaner. And then applying the natural Rubio monocoat finish, as well as chiseling my pants upon witnessing the immensely sexy crane unfolding upon my very eyes. Next day rolled around and I finally got my mini carver, which I'll review soon here on this channel. Up until then though, you can now watch me do my first ever power carving on a single slab table's live edge.
So after doing this for a few minutes, I know two things by now. First thing, it's extremely exhausting. I notice it here. It's such a weird motion. It's seriously exhausting. The other thing is that it works out like a charm, and I'm really satisfied with how it worked out. Brush shaping is done, and now all that's really left to do is to sand. Yeah, this is seriously cool. I like this thing. That is amazing. And the rubio monocoat is already pretty dusty, but that doesn't matter, I can clean it up. Most of the time I'm rather critical with myself, but this turned out nice. I seriously can't complain. If you wouldn't know better, you would think it's a live edge. Sure, nature is the best form of live edge there is, obviously, but this is pretty damn nice. If I would just feel under the table and wouldn't know it has been carved, I wouldn't know. I would feel, yeah, this is good. That's a nice live edge. Pretty satisfied. Gotta send this up to a higher grid next, and then we're already done with one side. Nice. I think on this side it's a bit more apparent that it's power carved, but nevertheless I think that it looks pretty cool and adds a lot of character to the piece. Yeah, now I'm going to power carve sand it up to 320 grit. I got a bunch of sanding discs here, and then we are basically on the finish line. What I noticed over the weekend when I left it here, it developed a tiny little bow. This whole tabletop. I asked my client and he said that it's fine, it's natural wood. We will never get it to be perfectly flat at all times because through the seasons it's going to bow and then it's going to unbow, etc. So I'm just going to leave it how it is. The difference on both sides in comparison to the to the top of the curvature is about 2 to 3 millimeters, so it's noticeable if you use a level, but other than that, it's not too much noticeable. My client is good with it, so I'm also good with it. I informed him about it, and we are both on the same page. Let's get to power sanding, and then we are basically done. Then we are going to sand all of the rest, and then we are going to coat it, and that's about it. Thank you.
And that's basically about it. There's not much more to it. Now we enter the finish line. At first came a horrendous amount of sanding, which took me about 2 hours. Again, I took all steps up to a 320 crit, and also water popped the surface and sanded again from a 150 to a 320 to get a really refined look. And after cleaning the bottom side and adding the base, it was time to add the finish to the top. The result really speaks for itself. Enjoy. Now, that turned out gorgeously, won't you agree? My clients were highly satisfied and the slab stayed completely flat and uncupped even after adjusting to its new home. I hope you learned something new today, just like me, and if you did, why not make sure to subscribe to the channel for more woodworking content. I post regularly over here, so definitely make sure to subscribe and support the channel this way. Also, I create handcrafted products over on my shop Stem.gu, so also check this out. Up until then, I'm wishing you guys a flammable day and please stay safe. Ciao!